Hey, what's up? This is Jonas Blue and we are in my studio at the moment and we're going to run through my track Don't Wake Me Up with Why Don't We. I've been working out this studio for about 2 years now. I think the first kind of finished song that I did here would have been my song Ritual with Tiësto and Rita Ora. This song actually came about in 2019 on Twitter, funny enough. I'd actually heard about the guys when I had one of my previous songs called Rise with a duo called Jack and Jack. I was just a huge fan of their sound, Why Don't We? And I love what they were putting out. And it took probably 2 years to kind of find the right song. The band sent me this kind of very early demo of Don't Wake Me Up, and it was just Corbin from the band singing it, and I just fell in love with it from that moment, and that's when we started working on the record together, and it took about a year. Usually I'd just fly over there and, you know, kind of record vocals or finish parts of the production, but it was very much remote, and I had an amazing engineer called Mitch Allen who recorded the vocals for me with the guys over there, and he previously did it for my song Rise as well, and he's just an amazing vocal producer, so they were in safe hands getting those vocals recorded. There was a lot of development from the original demo that they had sent me. The key wasn't quite right originally that they recorded it in. Change of a few lyrics and the way we did the chorus as well. A lot of this record, a lot of the pads were done on the Prophet 6, and then yeah, a lot of plugins. It's a hybrid of both really. The first time I played it was at Ministry of Sound. I have an amazing remix that I got from a friend called Seven, and I did a kind of mashup of the two together and it went down really well, so yeah, I was happy with that. Okay, so when I started Don't Wake Me Up, it started out as a ballad. This was what I'd heard when they sent it to me.
Sun kissed my face, wishing for the real thing. Lonely and out of place.
As you can hear, very much a ballad, but there was just something about the song that I just loved. I felt it kind of really, really touched you when you heard it, and I just loved it. So yeah, we got to work. I actually started working with the original vocals. I got them to send me those vocals knowing that I would at some point have to re-record it. The first thing that I started with is I knew that key was, it was just a little bit low, a little bit sad, and I thought we could make it almost a bit more happier sounding. If I look for the piano, so I think we went up a tone on this. We did some slightly different voicings as well. And yeah, it just felt great going to that key, and I worked it out with the guys. That was the key that best suited everyone in the end. So usually kind of, I think with a lot of dance guys, they kind of go straight for the drums and the bass. I'm actually very different. I go for more of the melodic stuff first. From this moment, I knew that I wanted to add almost like a bit of an emo guitar. If I play you the riff by itself. So that was the riff. So when you put that with the piano, it sounded so cool. Fun fact about this guitar riff. Usually I'd have my guitar player come in and we'd lay something down, but I just thought, you know what? Let's just have a look on Splice. When it's something like that, that is running alongside something else, I'm happy to use it. And if it sounds good, I'll keep it in. You know, I'm not too precious about that kind of stuff. And I was really, really happy at that point. It kind of had this anthemic, euphoric, just great vibe and very kind of heartly feeling as well. I knew that if I was to play that in a festival, it'd be that kind of hands in the air moment. You know, as soon as that piano and guitar comes in, it's a real moment. Originally, I used the vocals from the demo, which were this.
Sun kissed my face, wishing for the real thing.
However, slightly too soft, wouldn't work for this. So we did get the guys to re-record, and this is what it sounded like in the new recording.
Sun kissed my face, wishing for the real thing.
When you put those elements together.
Sun kissed my face, wishing for the real thing.
I really wanted to start this record off acoustic. You know, I wanted to kind of show the musicality to this record and it not just copy everything else that's out there. You know, I don't know many dance records that are kind of starting off acoustic. That was a big thing for me. I only really wanted to start adding rhythm the second half of the verse going into the pre. A classic thing that I'll do on most of my records is the finger snap. It's always on my records. It's a Cashmere sound, and I've just transposed it slightly. I pretty much tune every part of the record, so kick drums, snaps, claps, everything, it all has to work for me. And then I think I had just a very basic hi-hat going on here, just on every beat, and then the snap on the two and the four. That kind of idea that something's coming, something's building. One thing that I love to do on pianos is I'll bounce piano and then I'll just take pieces of that and reverse it. So you'll get these really nice reverses. And it just adds so much character to the piano after that. Cool little feature that we added there. So now we get to this part, which is the pre-chorus. At these kind of moments, I love to fuse a lot of my influences and the stuff that I'm listening to. So people like Kid Laroi and Bieber and all these kind of people, I love to kind of fuse those elements. What I've actually done here is the rhythm here is actually more of a kind of pop, rap, leaning records. The way I've done the kick and the bass is more how one of the rap or hip hop producers would do. They would kind of go for more 808s. So I've just tried to mimic that slightly. I think it is just a very, very basic legato bass. And you hear how the sidechain is slightly different on that. You can hear it. Because that was what the groove pattern on the kick was doing.
Do you bounce everything out?
In this case, I had to because there was so much going on in the project. I think this came from the Monarch plugin in Reactor. I love that a lot. I've not even added much to that, to be honest. It's just the slight ducking on the compressor. If I explain quickly the kick, so I've broken the kick up into kind of three different sounds. So that would just be from my sample library in the sampler. Second kick will be something a bit more MIDI. And this is the kind of more airy sounding, stadium sounding kick. So all three together. I've got some kind of cinematic sounding movie toms going on. Tambourine loop just to add some pace. And it looks like I've got some marching snares as well. All together. This great little sound that I use on a lot of the records from an Oliver pack. It's a great percussive guitar sound. Very Ed Sheeran. So that together. You've got all these kind of elements fused together of music that I love that's kind of out there at the moment. Heavy pop music, my knowledge of dance music, knowing to use the correct sounding bass to work with that. You know, I could have used an 808. I probably even tried an 808. It starts off very, very minimal in the intro and the first verse. The pre-chorus is when it really, you know, starts to come in and build up that kind of anticipation of something big is coming. Different grooves to kind of shock the listener slightly. That kind of kick pattern, that dun, dun, dun. Dun, dun, dun. Many dance guys wouldn't do that. Another thing that I've added in the pre-chorus is this pad. That came from the Prophet 6. That would have been something that I MIDI'd in. I would have been doing the filter cutoff at the same point, recording it in. And I like using the more analog stuff for things like that. I call it a French pad because it's almost like what the French house guys use a lot. This rave pad. That is something that I created out of silent, adds that width and that depth to those pads. Next section, chorus. So I can show you the vocals quickly. They were recorded by a good friend of mine, Mitch Allen, and they just sound amazing. In the middle of the night, 'cause I finally found you. So I've done some very minor tweaks because, like I said, Mitch is a great vocal producer. I love using this Arvox comp, so I've used that slightly.
Don't wake me up in the middle of the night, cause I finally found you.
It's already really heavily compressed, but I somehow felt the need to add a bit more. Had a slight bit of EQing on it, took some low end out.
Don't wake me up in the middle of the night, cause...
Boosted a bit of those low mids. A plugin that I really like to use is this Soothe plugin. I've used it as a de-esser.
Don't wake me up in the middle of the night.
With this style of vocal, it's supposed to be heavily compressed. That's what I wanted. That's the sound that I love. The Taylor Swift records, mixed by an amazing guy called Serban, and you know, he does the same thing. I love the sound of those vocals. Personal preference. First piano, I think, is from Keyscape. The second one I've got here is a classic dance piano in there. I think I would have tweaked it slightly with the delays, just created this really nice full sound to me. It's all being sent to a bus, some minor EQing on that. And then looks like I've got a Chris Lord LG 76 on there, going into an L2. I use a lot of wave stuff, yeah, always have done. I think because I've been using it for so long, I know that I can just go to it and it does what my ears know it to do. Between that and FabFilter, that's kind of my go-tos for a lot of processing. So this is almost now, we're in the kind of build-up section here. So I've brought the guitars back in. The one thing that I've added on this record, which is quite cool, rather than adding a riser, the typical kind of riser that people would add or what you would, you know, usually reach for, I thought, what about if it was the guitar feedback? And it just kind of comes in ever so slightly. It's almost like a string note. So again, with the pads, the guitar, and the bass. So that was a cool thing that I'd never tried on any of my records before. Basic string note, I mean, every dance guy does that. Just a held string note, and these are from Contact's string ensemble. Sounds like I've committed to the reverb as well that's usually on the plugin, and just done some slight EQing. Really simple stuff. If we go back to that build up, some of the sounds that I add there just to build tension and excitement, just a very simple Cashmere Ride that I've added there. We've got some more 909 sounding claps, and then I would have put the snap in here as well. And then a basic 909 build-up snare. That is an endless smile. So it's something that I'll just have on every project. It's part of my template. I don't necessarily use it all the time. I'll change the settings sometimes. But it's just a great thing to sometimes, you know, if you're working on a build-up or you just want to grab for something, just a quick dial. It sounded good to my ears, I guess, in the end. So first thing we can have a look at on the drop here. A lot of the time I can picture this stuff in my head of what I want before I even start. So I very much had a clear vision of how I wanted this track to sound drum wise. If we solo these drums and then I'll go through them. Very basic drums, but they sonically work really well in this record and hit really hard. It looks like I've only added two kicks. Big, thumpy, big house kick on this one. Second one I've added is just a kind of toppy, airy kind of kick, more for the attack. The two together. A drum machine that I used to use a lot was the SP1200. Even though it's not the same, I just love the sonics of like 12-bit. So I've downsampled that by two, put it on a resolution of 12-bit and added a slight bit of drive. I would have been aiming for that kind of 70s, 80s disco kind of sound on this. You got yourself a pretty big kick there. For me, it's all about choice of samples these days. I don't put things in to correct them. I'll put them in if I can hear they sonically sound right. It looks like there's a spinning kick there from a pack on Splice. I've taken an Oliver disco loop and just use the kick. I would have tuned them slightly. So yeah, you can see on this second kick, I've taken it up a tone. Like I said, I tune everything. So it very much differs from the original kick. Like I said, I used to use the SP1200 a lot. So I'll grab that from upstairs and go through packs that I've kind of created over the years. Anything. And this is one thing that I do a lot. I don't leave things on the grid. I'll shift things as and how I like them. So it looks like I've shifted a disco snare from Oliver's pack. And then I've got, looks like a Vengeance that I've changed the delay compensation, minus 15 milliseconds. It's just things I kind of do on the spot. I'll use Logic Sampler to audition sounds or even use sounds. I think you'll even find there's bits where I've just, yeah, look, hi-hats, they're still in the sampler of Logic Sampler. It changes every time, but that's kind of how I've done it on this record. If we have listened to the kick and those claps, snares together. There's some hi-hats. I usually kind of have four buses for a record, and that would be drums, instruments, vocals and effect. In this case, I've created a sub bus. Sometimes I'll do this if there's a lot of elements like percussion or hi-hats and I want them all to be sidechained. I'll do this kind of subgroup. I end up using LFO tool and I think I drew it in slightly and I've moved it just before the beat and I've got it on 100% as well. I'll have a few things that are being sent there. So this second one's going there. The drums are always a big focal point for me on those drops and I wanted to show you the kind of real ins and outs of those, of how I get those sonics. The bass line is made up of a few different layers. One of my biggest idols, as I mentioned, is Max Martin, and I would have got a lot of the inspiration from him and people like Shellback and Ilya and Ali Piami and people like that. The one thing they do on a lot of their bass lines is they move it a lot, whether it's rhythm or pitch bends. So you'll hear those pitch bends in there slightly, that are to kind of create the effect of a live bass. That was the first layer, which is kind of giving all the weight, the sub. Then I've kind of gone for this, if I remember, it was almost a bit future housey. And that's acting as the middle layer of the bass. Even though it's a more digital sound, I still wanted to create that effect that it was sliding and it's following almost what a live bass would do. Top end of that. It's almost like an FM sounding bass that I've used, all doing the same thing. So those elements together. That's the bass, very simple, but effective. Pianos, let's have a listen to that. This sounds like Spectrasonic's Keyscape, the grand piano on it, because I can hear all that kind of pedal noise and the room noise. You can hear it all there. I mean, I've added a lot of processing there. Bells of the piano, you can hear it, all the hammers, everything. You can hear it hitting there. You can see the processing that I've had there. Some OTTs, some EQ, Devil Lock to just absolutely smash it even more. I use this very rarely, but yeah, I've used it in this case. Some SSL compression. I really didn't want much dynamic out of this at all. It was more kind of just to be really squashed to get that digital sound, even though it's an acoustic piano. And then I've just used FabFilter's L2. I really like that piano. I think that's the only piano on the drop. It didn't need anything else. So from there, these are the stabs. So as you'll hear, I've committed to the reverb as well. I've not added any reverb onto that. Second layer. Like I said, I have a sub-channel for the drums, which is doing sidechaining. I also have one for instruments. Rather than putting sidechains on all different instruments, I'll send those instruments to a bus. So I'm using LFO tool on that, again, because I felt the kickstart wasn't quite working or Logic's one wasn't quite working. I've moved this slightly just before the beat. Layer three. I've got some pads going on here. That's come from the Prophet 6 as well, I think. This was when they brought out the update for the Prophet 6 and it had this vintage knob in there that you can now change. I think it's vintage or something like that. And I can hear that on there. You can hear it all detuning slightly. So yeah, all together, it's just very powerful. that's pretty much the drop on that. Second verse, it needed to keep up the pace, especially after a drop like that. If I would have just stripped it all back down again, the energy would have been completely lost. I've kept it very simple. There's a kick drum keeping the pace, and there's a bass line in there now. This is a really cool thing that I remember adding on the second verse. Rather than doing a kind of arpeggiator, it was a melody that I played in. I whacked Valhalla up 100, which you'll think is odd. I wanted it almost to create these kind of bells, but it's basically just a square out of Serum, and I've just played this melody in, which is doing this. On the first verse, I had all those kind of big stadium toms, tambourine, and the marching drums as well. It worked on that pattern that I did, that dun, 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 dun. When I got to the second verse, I thought, I wonder if that would still work. It should do, but I wonder how it would sound. And it worked great. I was really happy with that because I was able to kind of keep what people had heard in the first verse and move it over to the second, but change it as well. Tapping into my inspirations of music that I like at the minute, usually you'd add like 808 snares and you'd do those kind of triplets on those. I've actually done this on White Noise, and this would have been Logic's Basic ESP. That was a cool little thing that I added on this. And there really isn't much else to this record. There's some slight change in the vocals. Found you, yeah. So we got some of those just to kind of mix it up a bit that weren't in first time round. I had one of their ad-libs in the drop, and they were like, can you add this massive reverb to it to make it a moment for when we're performing? And I was like, absolutely. And I just thought that was a really cool idea to hear that from a band, that when they're performing it live, they can just get into that zone of it just being a big festival and things like that. So that's what's coming up here. And the one cool thing that I wanted to do on this record as well was the track started out acoustic, so I wanted to finish it acoustic. I wanted it to bookend how it started, and I thought that was quite sweet. So thank you so much for watching my breakdown of my single Don't Wake Me Up with Why Don't We. Make sure you leave us a comment and also follow me on my socials, which are in the description below somewhere here. So thank you for watching. I'll see you guys soon. Thank you.